You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Back by popular demand, Jim Earl. Hello, Jim. Do we have a bad connection?
I don't know. Do we?
Did you just belch?
Yes, I did.
On my show. Okay.
No, on my phone.
Hey, congratulations on being invited back to the David Feldman Show.
Oh, is that what this is?
Congratulations.
This is a great day in my life. Thank you.
Hey, Jim Earl. So how's Jimmy Dore? I want to challenge him to a fist fight. Seriously.
Is the only reason you have me on so you can dig at Jimmy Dore?
I think I'm going to fly to L.A., Marquee to Queensbury rules. I want to go 13 rounds with Jimmy Dore, see who's still standing. Would you relay that to him?
I see you. There you are going on with your elitist Queensbury rule thing from Harvard or wherever you went to law school.
We can do the Dingleberry rules, the Marquee to Dingleberry.
Does that come out of Yale?
The Marquee to Dingleberry rules are a lot of clenching, a lot of holding. You never say break up. That's the Marquee to Dingleberry.
A lot of pinching, a lot of loafing.
So seriously,
yeah.
Tell Jimmy Dore I want to get into a ring with him and go 13 rounds.
Well, what possible good would that do?
Just to see who's stronger, who's smarter at the sweet science of boxing. Who do you think would win if Jimmy and I went 13 rounds?
I think the American public. Who else?
So you're doing Jimmy's hugely successful show on YouTube with the Young Turks, right?
Well, I write a lot of things for this show, yes.
All right. Well, tell him I miss him. He won't return my calls. He is like the Republicans in that he needs an enemy. If he doesn't have an enemy, he can't get out of bed in the morning. He needs caffeine, and his caffeine isn't coffee. It's somebody slighted him. It's always an imagined slight, and that fuels his creativity.
Yeah, I can't imagine why he doesn't want to talk to you. I just don't get it after that.
Because when I run into him, like at the conventions, I weaken him. He's no longer angry. And then he goes, damn, now I have to think of somebody else to hate. Otherwise, my juices drain. He needs me to hate me. He has to see me as his enemy. Otherwise, he can't find a reason to get out of bed in the morning. I saw it when I ran into him in Philadelphia. He melted when he saw me because he loves me. And then he thought, I just don't have the time and energy to find somebody else to hate.
So this is what your therapist is telling you?
No, this is what I know about him.
This is what your therapist tells you this. In order to make yourself feel better about yourself, the therapist gets another paycheck.
Have you ever done therapy?
Only you pay your therapist in drink tickets. And coupons to flappers. Coupons to free passes to Bitburg's fart oven.
Bitburg's fart oven.
Yes.
Yeah, Reagan.
In Snatch Haven, Connecticut.
In Snatch Haven, Connecticut. Yep. Bitburg's fart oven in Snatch Haven, Connecticut.
That's right. It's an actual club, yes.
I know.
It's very popular.
They don't headline me there anymore. Snatch Haven, though, it's by the sea. Snatch Haven, Connecticut.
Well, it has to be.
Yeah, why?
Well, there are a lot of odors. You know, you gotta have those nice ocean winds coming along.
Uh-huh.
To help you out.
Right. Didn't you have, like, a little boat to go off into the water near Snatch Haven?
Oh, yes, the SS Queef.
The SS Queef? In Snatch Haven Sound, I believe it's called, you had a little boat, but you had a captain who would steer the boat, right?
Right. He was located in Cape Snatch, Cape Snatch. But yeah, he would steer the boat.
But he would disappear, and you had trouble finding that little captain in the boat, right?
This is getting dirty, and I don't like that.
In the boat. You always had trouble finding the little man in the boat in Snatch Haven.
That's right.
In Snatch Haven, Connecticut.
Well, now you've explained it. That makes absolute sense.
Did you live in Snatch Haven?
No one actually lives in Snatch Haven. You can only stay in Snatch Haven 3 weeks of the month.
And then
you got to leave.
And how hard is it to get to Snatch Haven? There's only one entrance, right? It's gated, right? It's a gated community. In order to get in there, you got to show ID, you got to do some sweet talking, right?
Yeah. Bring some liquor. Bring some liquor in the front.
Bring some liquor in the, front?
Right, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm living in Manhattan these days. I should probably try to visit Snatch Haven.
So, well, it's right up your alley.
Well, that's another town that I'm not allowed to visit. Now, up my alley, Massachusetts, that's a big Greek community, right?
Yes, it is a Greek community.
Greek community.
Right.
Up my alley.
You know, if you got a Snatch Haven on your three-masted schooner, they'll flush your mainmast from the mizzen on down.
Jim Earl, so let's talk about Georgia, the 6th District. You like this.
Oh, yeah.
Karen Handel, you like this woman. You said she's a Republican, but in name only. You think that she's going to take on Trump, and the people of Georgia made a wise decision picking her instead of Ossoff. Is that what you said?
No, I've never said anything of the sort.
You were the one who said General Sherman should have burnt the entire Confederacy to the ground. I think that's...
Yes.
Right.
I'm in favor of General Sherman. I think he should still burn it to the ground.
Well, it wasn't total war. I think a lot of the problems we have, and I don't mean to piss off our listeners in the South, but one of the reasons Germany and Japan, and we've talked about this before, one of the reasons Germany and Japan are so successful is we turned both those countries into glass, and then they had to rebuild themselves in our image, and they've surpassed us. I think the disfavor we did to the old Confederacy was not letting Sherman set fire to the entire South. We've done a disservice to our nation and to the South. We allowed remnants of their belief system to sustain over the years. And that's why we're in the trouble we're in, right?
Remnants of their belief system.
Yes.
Sure. I don't know what to say. I don't have any ancestors from the South, but you probably do.
Oh, yeah.
Because the Jews controlled the cotton industry. And they were primary slaveholders, weren't they? The Feldmans in particular.
Well, yes, the Feldmans. We owned a couple of plantations. And I remember reading my great-great-great-great-grandfather Jedediah Feldman's logs. He wrote, "We're paying the slaves nothing. How can we pay them even less?" He was trying to figure out. Jedediah Feldman was a senator to the Confederacy representing Georgia. He proposed legislation that would have charged slaves $50 a day for the privilege of being a slave.
Well, that's like being one of the slaves that Hillary Clinton had in the Arkansas State House. It was a privilege working for her as a slave labor.
She had slaves?
Well, she had prison labor, yeah.
Oh,
and they were all
right.
Black.
Right, right.
They were
right.
All black prisoners, around 30 years of age, been in there 18 years or longer. She found, according to her book, it takes a compound or a village or whatever the hell it is, the ones who were lifers gave her the least trouble. So she kept them. And the slightest mistake, she would send the others back to prison.
You're saying that when Bill Clinton was governor of Arkansas,
yes,
they would hire prison labor to work the governor's estate. Is that what
you're saying? Not hire. They didn't get paid anything. Maybe 7 cents a day. You know, that's what they get now. 7, maybe 15 cents a day or mm-hmm. hour, something like that. That's slave labor.
Right, right. And you're saying Chelsea is the product of a union, not between Hillary and Bill, but between Hillary and one of those prisoners.
I'm not saying that.
That's what you just said. You just.
Oh, I did?
You just said,
yeah.
Hillary, you said, and I can play the tape back, you said that Hillary and Bill went to Yale, which was in New Haven, Connecticut. It was
right.
50 miles away from Snatch Haven, Connecticut, which was one of Hillary's favorite places in the world. And she asked one of the prisoners to trim the garden to make it look like Snatch Haven. And then he stayed late. She poured him some lemonade. And she had a glass of lemonade and peed out Chelsea, because that's where babies
I like how you commit to this.
Because that's how...
Even when it's gone down the tubes.
That's how you make babies, right? You drink lemonade and then pee out the baby.
Is your mom still with us?
No, she had to go do Mark Maron's podcast. But well, she was pretty funny today, wasn't she?
What?
Yeah, she's still with us.
Really? How old is she?
I'm not allowed to talk about how old she is. She's very vain. Very vain.
But she's smart.
Veiny. Yeah, she's veiny.
She's part of the great generation, isn't she?
Yes, she was. She was tried at the Nuremberg trials. She was Eva Braun's hairstylist. Does that include the Germans when they say the greatest generation?
It does for some.
I think you would say the greater generation.
Greater. The superior generation.
Hey, they found a treasure trove of Nazi memorabilia in Argentina. Did you see this?
Yeah, I did.
And what was the thing? What made you laugh? There was one thing they found that I thought of you.
I thought it was the big Nazi mug with the handle on the inside. That made me laugh.
World's greatest racist.
You don't have to be racist.
You don't have to be racist to do this extermination, but it helps.
Right. And then there's hang in there, baby. after the assassination attempt and the show trials, the hang in there, baby poster.
Yeah. Was Rommel hung?
I think he committed suicide.
No, I'm talking about what his wife said.
Like I said, I think he committed suicide because he had a small penis.
God, I love talking history with you. It's so enlightening. One of the things they found was this compass to measure skull shapes. Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
Go look it up. Somebody brought to Argentina, the mugs and the bust of Hitler and these, I don't know what you call them, but they're skull shape measurements for phrenology, which you still believe in, right?
I believe in skull shapes. There are many different skull shapes, but I don't believe in phrenology.
You don't believe that you can determine the intelligence of an individual by the slope of their brow? Because I've heard you talk for hours on that.
I've never said that.
I've sat in bars with you, and you bought me drinks. You could bet a guy. I bet I can predict your SAT scores, sir, if you let me measure your brow. And you really, you don't remember that?
No, because I've never been in a bar with you. I would never allow that to happen.
Remember Barry Lank's impersonation of me when I was an alcoholic?
No, I don't. Please.
You don't remember what he used to walk around imitating me?
Was it something like, you don't know who I am?
Well, that, but he used to say, this is Feldman. Let's go get a drinks.
Yes.
Let's go get a drinks. You knew me when I was drinking.
You had the funniest plural, non-plural jokes of any comic out there.
What was I like drinking? I don't remember any of that.
I don't think I was around you that much when you were drinking.
I remember you came to my apartment with Barry Lank and your
yeah.
and I smoked a lot of dope and got drunk, and you and I got into a big argument. Do you remember that?
About what? Yeah.
It was the first time we had met, and you came into my apartment, and you pulled some sarcasm with me, and we started arguing politics. I don't know what it was about, but I remember thinking, this guy's an asshole. I could be friends with him.
And you had a balcony. I remember we were arguing on the balcony. It was like a cat on a hot tin roof or something. And you had a very expensive apartment in a totsy-totsy part of town.
What are you talking about?
We could never figure out. We could never figure out where you got your money from.
What are you talking? I lived on Dwight Way. I was living with three other guys. How was that an expensive apartment?
But the luxury inside that apartment, and you had a balcony.
I had a balcony, yeah. What else?
Yeah.
And a piano.
Well, the plumbing, the plumb piano, the baby grand, Steinway, 1920. You had gold fixtures.
The Gustav Klimt in the Airy.
Yeah, the Jan van Eyck painting in the foyer.
My butler was not British. He had a southern twang, which I was always ashamed of. Why do you say I had money?
You had a trust fund. You had a huge trust fund. You're a trust fund baby. We all know that.
A couple of billion. I went to a boarding school in Geneva to keep an eye on my father's Nazi gold.
You went to a boarding school for young boys.
Mm-hmm.
Had a lot of troubles there. But it really shaped your character in later life.
How so?
Well, you like horses a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You became a veterinarian, traveling from farm.
Traveling from farm to farm, yeah.
Putting your fist up a dairy animal's anuses.
Turns out that's not where veal comes from. I thought if you put your fist up a dairy animal's anus, as it's pronounced, veal would come out, delicious veal. And
are you familiar with Latin? Anus, anat, anat? Anus, anas, anat?
Anat? A balloon knot, I think, is how it's pronounced.
I love that. He loves ass. She loves ass. I'm glad this interview is going great.
I got up. I went to bed at 5 a.m. and got up at 6:30 to go do a seminar for FreshBooks. My friend Saul Colt, great guy, did a seminar for FreshBooks for people who are independent contractors. And I was on a panel at 8 in the morning at Caroline's Comedy Club, 8 in the morning, to talk about what it's like to be a freelancer. It's kind of interesting. So I'm sleep deprived. Have you ever had a full-time job? I guess writing, right? Working for Liz Winstead, working on The Daily Show. That was a full-time job, right? That's not freelance work, right?
That was a full-time job. We had contracts. In Air America, full-time, we had contracts.
And do you like
working non-union?
That's right. That's right. I know that Jon Stewart was very upset that The Daily Show was non-union.
Hey, you know, we shouldn't worry about the Georgia's District 1 results. You know why?
Why?
Because the Democrats are planning to rebrand the loss as enhanced winning.
I think it's Georgia 6, isn't it?
Or really?
I think.
Okay, I'll rewrite that.
Rewrite that. What's the best joke you ever wrote? Yeah. What's the one joke that you think, if I have to get into heaven and you're at the pearly gates and St. Peter says, I'll let you in, but you got to tell me the best joke you ever wrote. What is it?
I don't know. There's so many to choose from. But if I had to pick one that is kind of my favorite, it would be my dad's a horrible racist.
Yeah.
And when I say horrible, I mean he's just not very good at it.
Yeah.
He's always screaming things like goddamn Syro Hittites,
motherfucking Etruscans.
Etruscans.
Yeah.
He was out of touch.
Mm-hmm. He was old. Now, the Etruscans, right. Were they from central Italy? Is that who the Etruscans were?
Yes. I believe they were central Italy. They were before the Romans.
Were Romulus and Uncle Remus Etruscans?
I don't know.
Now, Romulus and Remus, I heard that Romulus was from ancient Rome, but Remus was from Greece. Said?
Yeah, I didn't see that one coming around the anus.
So your dad was a horrible racist.
Yeah.
That's your best.
Yeah, that was the end of that.
That was your best joke.
I don't know. I got others.
I like that. What was the first joke you wrote for stand-up?
It was a prop joke. I would go up there with a container of Head and Shoulders filled with tomato juice and do a mock commercial. I'd show it and I'd say, new improved Head and Shoulders. And then pour it into the glass, take a drink out of it. It's got sheep's blood.
And how did that go over?
Not very well.
Yeah. Were you disappointed by the intelligence of the comedy audiences when you were starting out? Did you think they were going to be a lot smarter than they turned out to be? Are comedy audiences limited?
No, I wasn't disappointed. It depends on which neighborhood you are in and what club you're in and the type of clientele that the club attracts. There were some very, very smart places and fun places to play. There were some kind of dumb and humorless places that were, you wanted to get off stage as soon as possible and collect your check.
Can you talk about anything in front of a comedy audience, even when you're famous? Can you talk about anything and keep their interest and get laughs? Or is comedy limited to just a few subjects?
I think you can talk about anything.
But can you get laughs and keep the audience's interest, and can you make a living and sell tickets? Or is comedy like pop music in that it has to keep this certain AABB structure?
Well, I don't know about any AABB structure, but I think people will laugh at anything if it's done right in a new and interesting way.
Are you a fan of Mort Sahl's?
Nah, not really, but I appreciate the precedent that he set. I appreciate his position in the history of comedy.
You don't think he's the best, as well as the progenitor of modern stand-up?
No, I think Eddie Cantor.
Mm. Seriously?
No, seriously, Eddie Cantor. Eddie Cantor, you can go on YouTube and look up his first talkie, and it's basically 20 minutes of him on stage doing a stand-up act. It's the first visual and audible stand-up I've ever seen recorded. And it's basically somebody going up and doing a stand-up act about how dumb their girlfriend is and all this kind of stuff.
I'm not that familiar with Eddie Cantor, but what I'm saying is, in terms of modern stand-up, Mort was the first one to talk about something other than his wife and his girlfriend. He was the first one to talk about something meaty.
The issues.
Yes.
I guess so.
Okay.
I guess.
And you don't think that's important?
Well, yeah, I do. That's what I mean. I don't think he's that funny. I think it's important. I think George Carlin.
Yeah.
There's somebody, his stuff lasts, and he grew. He was kind of like the Beatles of comedy. He would have a new incarnation, or he would grow with every trend, you know?
Mm-hmm. And is he your favorite?
For political comedy or something like topical political comedy? I guess so. He and the Smothers Brothers. I thought the Smothers Brothers were great.
That's interesting. The show or their nightclub act?
Both. And I thought they were dangerous. I think they were truly dangerous. And I think W.C. Fields is very subversive and, in a way, political comic, too.
How so?
I think he did more to comment on how America is full of dullards and people, family life can be so horrible and tedious. I think he was brilliant. Every aspect, visually and subtly and outrageously.
Mm-hmm. It's a gift.
He would mutter. Yeah, it's a gift. He would mutter things under his breath, which, you know, and he always say he was always in a fight with the censors too.
Right, and he would raise his hand to Baby Leroy, which was hysterical.
Right, right.
I mean, he would threaten to hit a baby. It's not funny to threaten to hit a threatening to hit a kid is like. ew, that's creepy. But threatening to hit a baby is funny, right?
Yeah, it can be.
All right. People love you on this show.
Well, not after this one.
This was our best one.
Do you have a happy Father's Day?
Yes and no. Yes and no. Means some of my kids called me. Mm-hmm. Well, they all called me an asshole. Yeah. See what I did?
Yeah.
Words are my tool. That was misdirection.
And your tool is constantly misdirected. Get it?
Yes, you're talking
You have a curved penis.
It's Peyronie's disease, right?
Peyronie's? Peyronie's disease.
No, that's when a woman gives you a blowjob and burns the roof of her mouth. That's Peyronie's disease.
When doesn't that happen?
Well, I, as you know, served in Vietnam, and my semen has Agent Orange in it, so kind of burnt. What?
Have you been doing stand-up lately?
I did it last night. Didn't go well.
Really?
Did not go well. Did not go well. I was at Dangerfields, and it went okay. It could have gone better, but I was tired. You know, it was like a cattle call instead of me and a couple of friends. It was a long night of comedy and waiting around, and by the time I got up, I was a little tired. But Peyronie's disease is where your penis curves to the left or to the right. Bill Clinton had that. Did you know
or
that?
Upwards.
Or upwards, if it's optimistic.
Right. Or your, downward.
Your penis curves upwards, and you had to go to the doctor complaining that you couldn't get it down. Most people can't get it up. I can't get it down.
Right.
Because it curves up.
Well, that's why I used to wander around the South, helping the people find wells with my penis. It would dip down during periods of drought.
It was a divining rod.
Yes, I would help starving farmers find water for their crops.
But then they accused you of actually making the water with the divining rod.
I mean, and exposing myself.
And exposing yourself. Oh, I remember a joke that Larry Brown hated of mine. Remember I came up with a heckler response?
Yes, I have one in particular, but you go ahead. I'll tell yours after you tell yours.
Larry was appalled. I said, somebody heckled me, and I said, hey, thumb dick, drop your pants and hitch a ride. Do you remember that?
Hey, thumb dick. Hey, thumb dick, hitch your pants and hitch a ride out of here.
Uh-huh. And I remember I said that one night, and I was so proud of that because I was, you know, learning to put down audience members. And Larry was appalled. Do you remember that?
I was there that night, yeah.
Hey, thumb dick, drop your pants and hitch a ride. And I shook my head with confidence.
I thought it was hilarious.
Do you really remember that?
Yeah, I thought it was hilarious for the wrong reasons. Also, you had another heckler line.
Yeah.
Hey, asshole, why don't you go to the bathroom and lick the semen off the walls? That was the worst thing I've ever heard you say.
I never said that.
Yes, you did.
Did I really?
You did.
No, I didn't. Did I really?
Yes.
Did I? Wait a second. But I didn't do that like, hey, I wrote a put down for hecklers. This is going to be like one of my stock put. Maybe I accidentally said that.
Remember that female sex therapist who was big in the 80s? What was her name? She had
Friday?
A German accent. Or something.
Ruth Westheimen. Ruth Westheimen.
And this, I still have this on videotape from an open mic at the Holy City Zoo that we hosted, and you came on stage. And you introduced your Ruth Westheimer joke. And that's the only thing I remember.
Oh, hang on. This had to have been like 85, 84?
Probably, yeah.
And you have this on videotape?
Yeah, 86, I think, yeah.
86. I always use was it me repeating something over and over again in her voice?
No, it was basically, and this Ruth Westheimer, what a whore. Wait a minute, that's not it.
I didn't say that.
This Ruth Westheimer, have you seen? What a whore. What a fucking whore.
I didn't say that.
And there's 30 seconds of silence with the mic feeding back.
I remember having a bit about her. I don't remember what the joke was.
Well, the next time you call up, I'll have the video ready to play on my computer and you can hear it.
You have video of me from 1986?
Yeah. Barry and I, when we hosted the Lank and Earl Freak Show and all those open mics at the Holy City Zoo, we would tape everybody we could on primitive videotaping machinery.
To laugh at them behind their back? Or did you think this would have some historical virtue?
Both.
You don't have any Feldo the Clown, do you?
I think I might have. No, I don't think I do.
Yeah, I don't think it exists. I know that I put the clown suit on again to be filmed by somebody, but I don't
you
know.
That was your problem. I don't understand why you gave up Feldo the Clown. That could have been like, that would have made you famous.
didn't work. It didn't work. How bad was I when I was starting? The audiences hated me, right? They still
no,
do.
The first time I saw you was at the Punchline open mic before I started doing comedy. And you came on with your glasses and a newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
Like Mort started reading the headlines. And this.
And what'd you think?
I thought you were trying to be Mort Saul.
I was. I was trying to be Mort Saul. Joked about taking a shit in his cat box.
This Melvin Laird.
Melvin Laird.
What an asshole.
That was Raymond Donovan. Yeah, I was like, yeah. Well, we don't need to. Memory lane. When did it all turn sour, Jim? When did it all go bad for us? At the beginning.
That never went bad. It's an unending pageant.
What was the best day of your life in comedy? The best day where you just go, well, I had this day. Everything was worth it.
I think it was when Barry and I first did the Russian roulette bit for the very first time on stage in front of like 40,000 people at Comedy Day in the park in San Francisco.
What was the Russian roulette bit?
That's where Barry says, we wanted to come out and try something different. And then I pull out a revolver and said, so we brought a gun. And and Barry says, that's right. I'm going to tell a joke, and Jim will point the gun at my forehead and slowly pull the trigger. If I survive, I will then turn the gun on him and do the same thing while he tells a joke.
Yeah.
We did that two or three times until I just kind of snapped and started snapping the trigger at his head. Sorry, folks. Sometimes I get a little impatient. And that was groundbreaking back then. Bring a gun on stage and make jokes about guns.
Mm-hmm. And there were kids in the audience.
Yes.
And you got off stage, and what did you think was going to happen?
I thought it was going to go well. I thought it was hilarious. I thought people would be shocked by it and find it funny, you know? And it still makes people laugh, I think.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever...
It's on video.
Did you ever fly to Hollywood thinking, this is it? It's going to happen?
Yeah, for a Burger King commercial tryout.
Seriously?
Yeah, we had a Burger King. Remember, they had Burger King commercial tryouts at the Holy City Zoo, and we get there late for it. And go up and just start yelling, Burger King sucks. I don't want to eat this shit. Fuck this. Our careers are over.
Uh-huh.
2 days later, we get a call. Hey, can you come down to L.A. and do a screen test for this?
Seriously?
Yeah, so we do it. It turns out they didn't want that.
Wait a second. So everybody showed up for this Burger King audition. You and Barry sabotaged it. And they picked you instead.
Yeah, right.
To mess with you, or they wanted rebels? I mean, what do you think was going on?
I think they liked the energy and the rebellious nature of it, to use cliche terms. But they didn't want that on. They didn't want that on video. They didn't really want that. Just like when you're hired to write for somebody, and we love your stuff. Now change it.
Right. Right.
Don't write like you usually do, but we love your stuff.
Well, that's the joy of being in charge. The joy of being in charge is that you can no longer get it up. So you hire young bucks and abuse them.
Right. You did that with your podcast.
That's what I would do. I was unable to get it up. So I brought in young talent, young men who were eager, who my wife was eyeing, and I try to break them. I would break them, break their spirit. It's the story it's the story of Hollywood, isn't it?
You made us spend a night in the box.
Uh-huh.
I'm not going any further with that. I can, you know, I know you're going, uh-huh.
Well, I was going
to elaborate.
I was going to say that you were going to win a boiled egg eating competition with my executive producer, but I didn't want to go down that. I thought the work we did when you, me, and Rosenfeld, Field, Rosen, how's Steve
Field.
Doing?
How's he doing? He's doing okay. He's doing all right.
One of the funniest people in the world.
He is. Incredible joke writer. Joke machine.
Yeah. We had some funny stuff. I got to dig up some of those sitcoms. They were funny. What do you
think? Yeah, you should.
Yeah, I know. I know. They were really great. So what are you going to do tonight? What are you going to do tonight?
I'm going to wait until the UV index goes down to 1. And I'll hopefully get on my bike and ride to Echo Park Lake, watch the geese and the ducks, and then come back and maybe have some fresh spring rolls at the only place I can afford to eat at anymore. And then watch Benjamin Cumberbatch on Netflix in the Sherlock Holmes series.
Hmm. And what are you reading?
I'm reading about the bombing of Dresden right now.
A lot of great toy factories were in Dresden, weren't they?
Yeah, a lot of dishes. A lot of dishes were broken that day, those days.
Well, they were having a Greek wedding at the time of the bombing. That really wasn't the Allies' fault. What was Dresden?
Yeah.
What was Dresden known for? Their dishes? Their ceramics?
They're known for their china.
How bad was Dresden?
How bad was it?
The bombings.
I mean, the result. Oh, it obliterated the town center.
Sucked the oxygen, right? They created so much heat, it just sucked the oxygen.
First day, the British came in and dropped bunker busting bombs. The function of that was to blow the doors, windows, and roofs off buildings. So the next day when the Americans, I guess, bombed with their incendiary bombs, it would make it easier to create firestorms.
Right.
Burn everybody.
The British bombed at night. The Americans refused to bomb at night. They would only bomb during the day, right? They didn't think it would be morally right to bomb at night.
I don't think it had anything to do with morals. I think it was just easier to see.
Right, but they didn't want to hit the wrong targets. But the British felt because of the Battle of Britain, it didn't matter if they hit the wrong targets.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah. A lot of back and forth in that war, you know? So much fucking, you know, people getting even with each other, you know? It's hard to take sides, right?
yeah, absolutely. Stay out of it. It's like, you know what that was like?
What?
America going into Europe during World War II was like a cop going on a domestic violence call. It's dangerous, and you don't know where it's going to come from. That's the most dangerous call a cop can make. You know that?
That's what I hear.
Well,
I think the most dangerous call a cop can make is primarily danger for the people they encounter. Because they're killing everybody.
Well, you've had positive experiences with cops, right?
The only positive ones I've had were ones when I didn't feel like I was going to be threatened completely. And that was because I'm a white guy. I've never felt comfortable around cops because a lot of them are insane.
Really?
In Texas, for, you know, Barry and I were, we just get out of, we're near Johnsonville, or, you know, we're.
Hang on, I have a bad, I apologize for this joke.
Mm-hmm.
So you, right. You hate the cops?
Yeah.
But they do the job that you're too afraid to do.
Yes.
Go ahead, you say it.
And what job is that?
You do it. You know where I'm going, and I can't help myself.
No, I don't know what you're doing.
You know what I'm going to say, and I don't want to say it, but I've only had an hour and a half of sleep. You do it.
I think I know what you're going to say.
So
but
you say it.
I'm not going to say it, no.
Cops do the job that ordinary Americans don't have the courage to do. Please. Thank you. Say it.
Go home and beat their wives?
All right. My audience knows where I'm going with this. Go ahead.
I have no idea what you're talking about because I don't think that way, you know? I'm a 22nd century man.
You're a 22nd century, and you can trace your ancestry all the way back to the Mayflower Moving Company. Weren't your ancestors like Huguenots or something?
Huguenots.
Weren't they Huguenots?
Huguenots?
I thought you were.
No.
Oh, no, they were balloon knots. And by that, I mean assholes. Get it? Balloon knots. It's a callback to.
I think they were Quakers.
Seriously.
Yeah, I had some Quakers. The Earls were Quakers. On the other side, they were Catholics from Prussia.
Your Quaker side, they like to sow their oats because. Hang on, let me explain. I've had.
They hauled out bodies and made little drums with them for kindergarten.
The Quakers did?
Didn't you used to do that with the Quaker Oats containers?
We weren't allowed to play with our Quaker Oats containers when I was a kid because my mother and father would say, Barbara Bush's face is on that box. Be gentle with it.
Barbara Bush. What a whore. What a fucking whore.
I never said that. I said she has bigger bags underneath her eyes than I have underneath my scrotum. And David Mamet heard me do that joke when I was opening for Jonathan Katz. And I apologized to him for that joke. And he said he loved that joke. David Mamet. So you're part Prussian?
No, that was like three generations ago.
That goes back to, like, the late 19th century.
1847, they came from Prussia, yeah.
Were you a Hollenholzen?
Elberfeld, the same town that Frederick Engels spent time in at the textile factory there and formulated a lot of his ideas from that with
Marx.
Marx.
He was like the Marshall Brickman to Karl Marx's Woody Allen. Right?
Right.
Marshall Brickman wrote Annie Hall with Woody Allen.
Where is he today? What's Marshall doing today?
He actually wrote some Broadway play and is doing very well.
Why don't you write a musical?
I can't say because I'm not gay, because that would be offensive. So I wouldn't say something like that.
Why don't you just say because you're not talented?
Because that's not as funny as saying because I'm not gay. But I wouldn't say that because that would imply that anybody in musical theater is gay. And that's not fair.
No, it isn't. You don't want to do that.
No, some of them are gay. You're offended.
Right, I don't have to respond to that. But thanks for drawing me into this.
What? You were the one who was saying that we should still be bombing Dresden.
No, I never said that.
You said you never understood why the Allies stopped bombing Dresden and that it would be a good job maker to bomb Dresden again. You just said that.
Well, it sounds like a pretty smart thing to say, but I never said that.
So you're
I can't take credit for that.
You're reading a book about Dresden. Who wrote it?
Yeah, I can't remember. Some German guy.
And what book did you read before that?
I haven't read in a long time because the spark of life has been snuffed out in my soul. I don't have any desire nor the energy to read fiction any longer.
So what about this fist fight with Jimmy Dore? I'm going to get back to that. Can you make it happen?
You'll have to contact him yourself over that. I have no control over any of this. And I highly advise against it because I think you'd lose just like that.
What about a duel?
Yeah, what kind of instruments?
Guns at three paces.
Hmm.
Would you be my second?
No. I don't want to...
I'd
highly advise against any of this.
I'm challenging him to a fight or a duel.
You're just obsessed because someone is rejecting you. You should lay that to peace and move on to another person you can harass.
Has a woman ever accused you of harassing her?
Not to my knowledge, because I wouldn't be caught dead listening to one, right?
I didn't say that. I never said
that. You told me to say that.
Well, I'm a fan of women, as you know. They're my third favorite. Hang on, I have a joke. They're my third favorite. Yeah. They're my third favorite gender.
Yeah.
I just made that. I made that up. And you stepped on it. I came up with a joke today during the Fresh Books seminar. Mm-hmm. I was talking about raising millennials and got so bad raising millennials, I had to give my daughter a trophy for getting a trophy. You get it?
Yes, I do. What you're saying is that the millennials are kind of spoiled. Uh-huh. They expect everything to fall in their lap, that kind of thing. Yeah, I understand where you're coming from with that one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You spoke at a book forum?
No, it was for...
You've never written...
No, it was for Fresh Books. It's accounting software. And I was asked to join a panel discussion and talk about freelancing as opposed to having a steady job. It was interesting.
Right. And you know lots of powerful, talented people in the business. You're never at a loss for work. As a matter of fact, every time you work and find a job, no one hears from you for like 10 or 12 months afterwards.
And why do you think that is?
Because you're a coward. Because you think everybody's going to try to take your job away from you? When all we want to do really is congratulate you and share in your newfound fortune. That's all any comic wants to do when another comic gets a job.
If I'm working full time, I barely have enough energy to pull my pants down to take a leak. Because I have to sit. Most people unzip their fly to take a leak. I have to pull my entire pants down to take a leak. And why is that?
Right.
Why is that?
I have nothing on this one, Dave.
Well, there are various ways we can go here. We can go positive and say my cock is so huge it doesn't fit through the zipper and the fly, so my pants have to go all the way down to my ankles. That's one way to go.
Right.
Or I'm so old, I can't control all my orifices at the same time. If one opens, they all open, so I have to sit to pee because
You can't even chew gum and shit your pants at the same time. You know, I'm sure anybody listening to this far who's been able to, well, thank goodness at the occasional laughter. That happens every 10 minutes of complete and utter stultifying boredom. Why don't you promote your new book?
What's it called?
Just published.
What's it called?
It's called Ferrets versus Feldman.
Oh, come on now. Be nice. Be nice.
No. What's wrong?
He's a funny man. Who was your favorite office mate? Did you ever have to share an office with somebody?
Mm-hmm. Yes. That would be A. Whitney Brown.
Oh, wow.
That would be right up.
Wow. I was just thinking about him. He was something.
He was hilarious. He was always fun.
Yeah. At the School Book Depository building in Dallas, on the sixth floor, you shared an office with somebody.
Yes, my conscience.
How much time before tragedy becomes comedy?
5 minutes.
Okay.
Who do you think shot them?
Who do I think killed Kennedy?
Yeah.
Well, I think, in all honesty, I think that it was probably elements within the CIA and the mafia and the deep, dark state that conspired.
So you believe in the deep state?
I believe that there's a deep state that doesn't control America, but America can't control it. And I think they sometimes...
I agree.
Right? I think they bubble up sometimes. I think it's, you know, a ne'er-do-well child who can't really harm you, but occasionally gets your social security number, takes out a credit card, and buys a small militia. That's what the deep state mm-hmm. is. That's what I think. You know, folks, what we're doing right now, we used to do this in front of a live audience.
I agree.
We used to do this. All right, my friend, you'll come back. I got fan mail for you. Somebody wrote in. Hang on. Like today. Hang on.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's good to hear from.
Let me read it to you. Divorce, divorce, divorce. Divorce, divorce, divorce. Divorce, divorce. I'm going through my Rancho Gordo.
Rancho Gordo, heirloom beans.
Heirloom beans. You turned me on to heirloom beans. Jim Earl, where is this? I got it today. I get so many angry emails. Here, more Earl. Thank you, David, for doing the episode on Medicare. Blah, blah, blah. Really hope to hear more from Jim Earl. He's hysterical.
Well, that's nice. That's very nice.
Yeah.
They must not have been listening.
Yeah. I get a couple of them.
You should go out to a bar.
And start drinking again.
Yeah.
Ray James is in town. He wants to go out, but I've had like an hour and a half of sleep. Did I mention that?
Yeah, but keep on doing that. Trump gets no sleep, too.
That's true. Thanks for doing this. How do people
in court.
See in court? How do people hear the Clutter family, get your tweets, read Morning Remembrance, and all that good stuff?
I'm Jim Earl 666 on Twitter. You can Google Morning Remembrance with a U in my name, and you'll find the book of funny obituaries. There's a lot of compromising pictures of me on the internet as well. So enjoy.
And let's hear your closing, your famous closer.
If you've been drinking, please don't drive. A dead customer is not a repeat customer.
I thought you were going to say see you in court. I love that.
Okay. Set me up again.
Hey, Jim, I'll see you in court.
What about this Ruth Westheimer? What a whore.
I wish I knew what the joke was. I never called a woman that on stage. Never. Never.
Okay, this is a challenge. This is a challenge. I'm going to look it up, and I'm going to, yeah, it's there. I got it.
You think in the Bay Area in the 80s, I would call a woman a whore? Do you really think?
I can't. Don't. Once again, I do not know how to answer one of your questions.
All right. I'll see you in court.
Okay.
Tell Jimmy Dore it's up to him. pistols, fists, or swords. But I'm challenging him. Okay?
You should have a hard-boiled egg contest, eating contest. Do that.
You know what they said after the boiled egg eating contest?
What?
What we have here is a failure to defecate. Because boiled eggs. all right.
You're listening to Highlights from the David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.